The Garden by Paul Perry and read by Ruairi Conaghan for Saga Egmont. I feel as if heaven lay close upon the earth and I between them both, breathing through the eye of a needle. Lawrence Durrell, Justine. Because the world is so full of death and horror, I try again and again to console my heart and pick the flowers that grow in the midst of hell. Hermann Hesse, Narcissus and Goldmund. Chapter 1. When I first saw Romeo, I thought, here comes trouble. I was outside the house smoking. The sun was setting over the farm, the light dusky. He walked without purpose up the long gravel driveway. A worn green canvas carryall slung over his back. He wore a pair of torn jeans and a white cotton shirt. He looked like he'd been walking a long time, as if he'd gotten lost or taken an unwanted detour. His boots were dusty, his face sunbeaten. Even in his youth, there was a lassitude about him, a sense, as he approached, of confusion and weary disdain. "Hello," he said, stepping from the shadows. His voice surprised me. There was none of the urgency I was expecting. Instead, there was pride, apathy, and a familiar Latin inflection. "You heard the boss?" "Not me," I said. I threw the butt of my cigarette to the ground and stubbed it out. "I'm looking for the orchard keeper." "He's resting," I said. He swung his bag from his back and put it between his feet. "I'll wait," he said. He looked about him, took in the house, the barracks, orchard, greenhouses, labs and sheds. He saw the workers bending to their business, cutting, sawing and hammering. A quiet hum of industrious activity all around. "I'm Swallow," I said. He held out his hand. "Romeo," he grinned, then shook my hand strongly and let it go. So this was Romeo. I'd been expecting something else. Blanchard had said he was bringing expertise to the garden. Not a man on foot, looking as if his every belonging was in a bag by his feet. Not someone so young. His youth, it smacked of inexperience, and that's not what we needed. After a time, I said, "There's no sense in waiting here. I can show you your bunk." I pointed to the barracks where our casual labour slept. He considered what I'd said. "Give you a chance to rest before Blanchard wakes." He looked unsure. Regardless, I walked towards the barracks. Eventually, he followed. "He likes a siesta?" Romeo asked darkly. "And the boss?" "He's in a blue funk," I replied. He looked behind him down the path he'd just trodden, the sun dropping farther, the sky spoiling. There was something regretful in his gaze, his eyes dark and downcast. Half a dozen of the workers passed us and bid us good evening. Romeo kept quiet and close. We went into the barracks. A harsh-sounding structure, but it wasn't. It was simply what we called it. A glorified shed. It had hot water, showers, a small kitchen, and a host of bunks. Granted, it had taken a hammering. But it was repaired now. Mostly, though it creaked and sang in the wind. I'd somehow got used to it. I showed the new man the spare bunk at the back and he threw his bag onto the mattress. The other beds were covered with clothes, boots and sneakers lined each one beneath. The setup was like something a sorry battalion of lost soldiers may have endured, all discipline gone. Still, it was not quite the doss house it might have been. We had our rules. Romeo gazed up toward the skylight and then to the back door, which was open, offering a frame to the wire fencing that enclosed the farm. A gentle breeze blew through the building, welcoming in the maw of humidity. "The John is through that door," I said, pointing. "Showers too. You can do your laundry come Sunday." "Laundry?" he said suspiciously. I shrugged. At this stage, I didn't know what Romeo did or did not need to know. I had no idea how long he would even be here. Granted, you could say that about any of the workers who came and went. Mostly folk picked up whatever it was they needed to know throughout the working day by talking to one another. but what Romeo wanted to know and what he needed to know was not clear to me. Some of the workers had left before the hurricane had hit, but there had always been a steady flow of more of them to take their place. Blanchard had called me to the office and asked me to make room for the new guy. This meant vacating one of the beds in the barracks. Not a problem. But I never liked to let a good man go, even if Blanchard was having difficulty paying them all. So I released Xavi, a young Argentinian worker with a wife and child living elsewhere. He was doleful, but didn't dispute the dismissal. And as the days neared to Romeo's arrival, I'd sensed a certain curiosity in me grow, something I'd not anticipated. A change, an excitement even, strange though it felt. I tried to imagine what this new man made of the place. He looked like he'd seen and survived worse, and with the muted swagger about him. I sensed too that he'd also experienced something more magnificent, something more excessive, as if there was a touch of the gambler about him. Still, he hadn't seen the extent of the damage. "Show me around," he asked, eyeing his bag. "It'll be safe," I said, as if to reassure him. I could have told him how when there last was a dispute here, it had ended in blood, a pull of it not far from his bunk. I could have told him how the wronged party had cornered the man and how Blanchard and I walked away while justice was meted out. The smell of bleach only served to remind us of the cost of committing a crime here, in the garden, as Blanchard called the nursery and grounds around us, as if it had some Edenic quality to it. Maybe it had, once upon a time. Blanchard had bought the land only 10 years previous, when it was nothing but wasteland. Slowly, he'd flattened the terrain, paved the road access, and introduced electricity and water. Now it amounted to 60 acres of outdoor and indoor growing. We were far enough from the highway, behind full tree coverage, and secured by perimeter fences for privacy. Surrounded by wooded acreage with no neighbours to speak of, there were 5 sawtooth grow houses, a glazed-roofed mist house, and a number of shade houses. The garden had been a haven for growing and selling orchids, that is, until the hurricane hit. We walked out into the dusk. Around us, the sounds of Spanish faded. About the perimeter of the grounds, I pointed out the various repairs which required attention. Swathes of fencing had been torn down. The fig and orange trees of the fruit orchard were bent or breaking. Large branches lay snapped on the ground, waiting to be removed. 2 banana trees were shredded. Shade cloth was in ribbons. The bamboo was stripped, pots smashed, and a trailer remained on its side. The violence of the hurricane was apparent everywhere you looked. "It's worse than I thought," Romeo said. The fields were mostly drained, but there was still a faint sucking sound with each step we took. "If you've come for hurricane repairs, you're late." I meant it as a joke, but Romeo didn't laugh. He kicked at the wheel of a backhoe. I showed him the boilers and the backup generator, crucial during hurricane season, and the heaters, fans, the temperature and irrigation controls. Then there was the metal building with the loading dock and, of course, the greenhouses. "There's a lot left to do," he said. He was right, and the enormity of the work remaining depressed me, together with the thought that another man was not going to make much difference, no matter what his expertise was. Unless, of course, Blanchard's plan came off. "But that's not all I'm here to do, no?" I shook my head. I wasn't sure how much he thought I knew about his appearance or how much I should let on I knew. Blanchard could be evasive at the best of times. I'd learned not to ask too many questions. We all had. So I didn't know what to tell Romeo. For months, Blanchard had been blighted by stress and anxiety at losing most of our orchid stock. There was talk of debt and insolvency, and though he was a man of many ideas, his obsession was orchids. And after the hurricane, he decided we needed to do something radical. What he wanted was the ghost orchid. That, he reasoned, would make everything right. The unattainable, the magical. A flower which by its very existence suggested there was no death. That time did not somehow unravel like a stitch of cloth thrown into a ravine. "Were you here when it hit?" "Yeah," I said. "I was here." The hurricane that came through the garden had gained momentum over the gulf, and when it landed, It had almost destroyed the place. I told Romeo how it had pummeled us, how the barracks roof had been torn off. I told him the main house itself had been shuttered. Its windows had barely remained intact, but its side and panelling were pounded and needed attention. The greenhouses had been levelled, but had been mostly rebuilt. The sound of the wind was like gunfire, I said. I'm not sure Romeo wanted to know any of this. I think maybe he was looking for a way in, a story, something personal maybe. So I told him how the men and I had watched the news on the TV Blanchard had installed in the barracks. Some of the men had decided the garden was not a safe place to be and had left. Who knows where they went? North to Georgia? Or home, wherever that was? We never saw them again. That's how it goes. Others had nowhere to go. They stayed. Some didn't believe the warnings, or they didn't care, and kept about the storm protection work we gave them. We went on hurricane watch. Not long after, evacuations became mandatory. You'll stay? Blanchard had said. I had nowhere else to go, so I said, sure, I'll stay. I guess Blanchard appreciated that. We went to work and tried desperately to secure the garden's buildings. I was trying to give Romeo a sense of what it was like, so I said, once I was in a thunderstorm. Oh yeah? He said. I was flying from Chicago with a friend, and we were struck by lightning. No. People shot out of their seats. The plane stalled, then dropped. You thought you were going to die? Pretty much. And? And the hurricane? It was worse. I told him when it landed, the remaining men and I had hunkered down in the main house and listened to one of them, Miguel, pray. He'd been high as a kite, and I said, I watched him walk out into the storm and let the rain wash over him like he was some kind of lunatic preacher. Romeo closed his eyes as if he were imagining the scene. I didn't say Miguel was lucky not to have been swept away by the winds or to have been hit by lightning. Romeo had already seen the mess. He could figure the rest out for himself. Welcome to paradise, I said. It was something we said to every new recruit. Blanchard had said it to me. I was aware that to say it now, it sounded ironic, cruel even. There was a hint of irritation in my voice. I don't know why. Where were you? I thought. How could you not have known the hurricane was bad? I said, afterwards there were nights when we slept beneath the stars. Romeo asked me where I was from. I told him Ireland. He looked at me from the corner of his eye, taking me in. Then we made our way through the grounds and talked some more. Your English is good, I said to him. He said he'd learned a lot of English when he'd gone to Belize to study. He didn't say what or where from, and he gave me the impression that he didn't want me to ask. As the sun sank beyond the horizon, we returned to the office. When can I see him? Romeo said then. Darkness was falling. You could hear the ticking of cicadas from the gloom about us. Tomorrow, I said. He was disappointed. You said he was taking a nap. He was, but the jeep is gone now. That should have been enough of an explanation, but not for Romeo. I need to speak to him, to tell him I am here. I shook my head. It looks like he went to eat with his wife, Mirabel. I need to discuss the details of my employment. For some reason, I thought what he'd last said was funny, and I began to laugh a little. This only made him mad. The purposeless gait up the driveway had given way to an urgency, and if I'm not mistaken, a desperation. Still, I knew not to call Blanchard, not even with the arrival of the new man. He was protective of his time with Mirabel. Tomorrow, I said. We walked back to the barracks, and he sat on the edge of his bunk. The others eyed him warily, but he ignored them. He remained resigned. He may even have been exhausted. He unzipped his bag and surveyed his meager belonging. The usual, toothbrush, a pack of smokes and some clothes, a maroon hoodie, a pair of jeans, socks and briefs. For a split second, I felt like he was a kindred spirit of sorts, or that at one time I was him. Arriving somewhat hopefully to the garden, walking up the gravel path with nothing to my name, no country and few belongings, only to be disappointed, as if I'd come to a dead end. He was undocumented, I imagined, much like I was, one of the lost, of a legion where the endless highways of traffic, the desolate drinking holes, the daytime neon and violent pulse of sunlight, the ever unpredictable wash of sleepless nights, and the memory of what had been, and the bitter broken pledge of what could have been, beat through my blood on and on into each insomniac night. He reached into his bag and pulled out a face cloth. There are always people like us. Like us? To clean up. He smiled. The boss wants more than that. He wants to be rich, Romeo said, burying his face in the cloth. Now it was his turn to laugh, but his laughter was callow and thin. Sure, but first, he needs to keep this place from going under, I said. Romeo wiped the day's grime and dried sweat from his face, and for some reason, I began to be wary of the wiry man before me. He sensed my recalcitrance and folded his cloth away. I could tell the other men had been listening. I paused and let the silence return. Eventually the men filled it. They whispered to themselves about their families, about food and money. Later that night, as I smoked outside, I heard the jeep return. The engine died and the doors opened. There was the sound of voices. They were neither hushed nor raised. Blanchard was speaking in his curt but polite fashion. Mirabel was listening patiently, replying with considerate humour. Their words wavered in the air. Then the jeep door shut. They walked inside. From where I sat on the barracks desk, through one greenhouse and another, I could see a light go on. I imagined Blanchard going to the cabinet and pouring himself and his wife a drink. I imagined him lighting a cigar. Their house had been battered. Shutters had been unhinged, windows smashed. The roof needed attention. After the lab, it had been the priority repair. I heard Romeo stir. Here was another insomniac, or at least the kind of person who slept with one eye open. He came out onto the deck. We didn't say anything to one another. He went to sit in the hammock. Back and forth he swung, blowing smoke into the night, watching the movements of Blanchard and his wife within the house. After a time, I went back to bed. The tension in me disappeared. For weeks, I'd wondered who the new man would be, and now he was here. What I felt at that moment was something else, a kind of frustration. Something had shifted within the garden. Its energy had been displaced. I was no longer tense, but I wasn't easy either. I recognized a quiet thrumming in my blood. The new man reminded me of someone. He reminded me of my brother Jamie, or what he might have been like. Outside, Romeo lit one cigarette after another, his lighter clicking open and shut, punctuating the nightfall. The men turned over in their sleep. My eyes grew heavy. Around me, the mosquitoes buzzing rose and fell, and still the old hammock swung and squeaked. The next thing I knew, it was morning. Chapter 2. For the past few years, things had been much the same. Blanchard was the boss, with Mirabel, his wife, and sometimes assistant, by his side. There was the ageless Miguel, the Mexican, referred to sometimes by Blanchard as my man Miguel. And there was the barracks crew who, though not fixed as such, inhabited the barracks most months of the year. In fact, there had always been a steady flow of workers. Many stayed for a season, but few stayed much longer. There was no need, and no work for them during the low or off season in any case. A few returned, but most were incarcerated, deported, or even killed for one reason or another. If they were lucky, they found work elsewhere. The only ones who stayed were stalwarts, all trusted, unquestioning workers. After the hurricane, it was all about repairs, but there were cost implications, and Blanchard was not a generous man. Stock had been decimated. He discussed whether he could even afford stormwater management systems, and yet he was willing to take a risk on Romeo. At first, I wondered what he could do that nobody else could. What were his special set of skills? When I said as much to Blanchard, he replied evenly, "He's the kind of man we need." "What do you mean?" I asked. He has what it takes. These were cliches, and Blanchard knew it. He was not normally a man to indulge in hackneyed language, so when I persisted, he finally gave way. It's to do with our stock, he said. I need something special in order to bounce back. It's true we had experienced losses. The insurance companies took months to reimburse if they ever did, and it rarely ever matched the actual value of what was lost. My first thought then about our new man was that he could do something Blanchard, Mirabel, or I could not. A specialist, in other words. The ghost? I said to Blanchard. Is that what this is about? Neither you nor I know how to breed it now, do we? So yes, Swallow, it is about the ghost. I didn't want to be involved with anything illegal. I hadn't renewed my permits to stay in the country, which was my own fault. A wariness I had with authority after the military. So it meant my life for some years now was under the radar and off the books. I didn't want to do anything which would jeopardize that vulnerable position. And yet, having worked here for years, I'd become bewitched by the ghost orchid, and often heard Blanchard talk of finding it deep in the Fakahatchee Strand. And when he discussed how the ghost was something the garden needed to survive, I began to feel I finally had a mission in life. The ghost gave me that, in many ways. It kept me at the garden. The next morning when I woke, Romeo was standing over me. Bring me to the boss, he said. It sounded like an order, but as an order it was hard to take seriously. He was half-dressed, and his hair was wet. He looked more like a kid than the man who'd arrived the previous evening, impatient rather than eager. It wasn't quite dawn. Outside, the dark was giving way to the morning sun. It was still weak, but would soon climb steadily. Even this late in the year, there was heat in its ascent, but not as much. It already felt like winter was on its way. Blanchard will be here in good time, I said. I need to see him, Romeo replied impatiently. I didn't know what to say to this. It wasn't the way we worked. Sure, Romeo was different to our other labor force, but for some reason I wanted him to wait. I carried on with my morning preparations, a cigarette on the deck, bitter black coffee. Romeo seemed always to follow, with his eyes, if not with his person. He was ever watchful, ever wary. What am I to do? He said in Spanish. Most of the men's English was poor, and I'd picked up enough Spanish along the way to communicate with them, and between the languages we made ourselves understood. But there was no issue with Romeo. Maybe start by getting dressed, I said. Then you can muck in. The barracks crew were getting dressed, smoking, drinking coffee, talking. There was a quiet reverence to the routine. I sat up and pulled on my boots. Miguel approached. Without saying anything, he handed Romeo a mug of coffee. Romeo took it wordlessly, went back to his bunk and finished dressing. Those boots, I called to him. They're no good for the fields. He looked down at the soft leather of his cowboy boots and shrugged. I didn't come here to work in the fields. I'll find you something, I said, and dug out a pair of steel-tipped work boots, which I placed by the end of his bed. He looked at them briefly with amusement and ignored them. You're the new guy, Miguel said. Romeo sipped his coffee. What will you do here? Romeo was looking into his cup. I answered for him. He's working with us, I said. Of course I knew the others would speculate. Why were we taking on a new man when we had to let others go? Where's the money coming from? But I also knew they wouldn't say anything. We worked together. We ate together. Sometimes we drank together. If one of the men were green or homesick or not right, they might share something of the past or something personal. But it was a rare and unwise thing to do, in my experience. We kept to ourselves. It was safer like that. Come on, I said to Romeo, and he followed, lighting a cigarette and squinting into the early morning sunlight. Miguel came too, but instead of walking next to us, the new man walked a little behind, as if he were shadowing me, literally looking over my shoulder. I said, the first thing to do is check the sprinklers, then see which flowers need water and what plants want fertilizer. Romeo nodded nonchalantly but looked confused. I'm here for the ghost, not this. I know, I said, but we don't have it. You don't? No. And until we do, you can help out, okay? Blanchard appeared at the shade houses. A tall, lank man, he was cleaning his glasses with the end of a red bandana. The gesture covered for the formal, serious man he was. He took the brown, flat-brimmed rancher from his head and swatted away the flies.
You're here, he said to Romeo.
He arrived last night, I said. The two men shook hands.
He told me not to disturb you, Romeo said.
Blanchard nodded.
How was your journey? Nothing too eventful, I hope?
No, Romeo said dolefully.
Good, good,
Blanchard said, pointing to the tangled shade cloth which lay about us, black and shroud-like.
As you can see, things are poorly. Not to put too fine a point on it, but we are struggling. Come, let us show you around what we once called paradise and which is now, well, something else.
He turned and beckoned us to follow him, and together we walked through the garden where the cord grass was long and wet. Blanchard turned to Romeo.
But we're happy you're here, you know.
He put his arm about the man awkwardly.
Very happy. We've been waiting for you.
Romeo smiled.
I'm looking forward to getting to work, to seeing the lab.
Blanchard looked determined, earnest.
Yes, he said, the lab, of course.
But we didn't go there. There was so much still left to do. Repairs were ongoing. I sometimes wondered if we'd ever get back to normal.
Swallow, Blanchard called. Break it down.
I began with my morning update. Number of men present, itinerary for the day's repairs, stock, outside jobs, figures, inventory, stuff like that. Blanchard wanted a detailed itinerary. He wanted it verbally, and he wanted it quick fire. It was always a part of the morning which rattled me. What worried me that morning was that the temperatures in the greenhouses needed to be right, but the thermostats were old, and many of them were simply not working after the hurricane. We need new thermostats, I said.
Yes, Blanchard said,
but his tone wasn't reassuring. In fact, it was as if he wasn't listening to me at all, as if he was too distracted by the immensity of the task to really take in the detail of what needed to be done. So much so, I was pretty sure I'd be saying the same thing about the thermostats again the following week.
What about the ramp to the load house? He asked.
With the barracks to our rear, three greenhouses stood before us, and behind it, the lab. The ramp had been smashed, and it hadn't been repaired. Because we weren't expecting any deliveries, I didn't think it a priority. Romeo stepped closer to me. As I struggled to answer Blanchard, it felt like the irascible impatience of Romeo had not dissipated. It felt like he was on the verge of saying something, of blurting out, at any moment, a sliver of pique which would unsettle everyone. Blanchard waved his arm. Cut, he said, meaning the grass. The request was noted. Miguel beckoned two men from their chores in the fields, and when they came, he doled out instructions. And the men went about their business in silent obedience, machetes in hand. Blanchard smiled and turned. He walked steadily towards the ostrich ferns and held a leaf in his hands. Gently, he massaged it between his finger and thumb, pulled at it, and placed it into his mouth and chewed. Then his attention was drawn to one of the men who balanced a watering can over a potted orchid.
One of the few survivors, he said to Romeo.
Water flowed onto the flower's roots and dripped onto the table. The man mopped his brow. A good deal of order had been restored. The tables and protective structures were once again intact, but there were still a ways to go. The greenhouses had been mostly jerry-rigged, but a torn screen door, a stop sign, and other wind-blown garbage still littered the fields about us. And yet there was a beauty to this scene. The sheer variety and vibrancy of plant life seemed to dye my field of vision. You could almost feel the thickets breathe. Romeo reached out and took the watering can from the man.
Too much water, he said. It's damaged.
He pointed to the bruised stem.
See? It needs to dry out.
He handed the plant back and Blanchard smiled before walking on with the rest of us finally in tow. I oversaw the repairs. Blanchard called it the rehabilitation.
In my opinion, his stewardship of these efforts was suspect, lacked a certain and necessary application. I guess the financial strain he was undergoing was too much for him. For a variety of reasons, I'd wanted to take more control, but I'd either not been allowed or hadn't made my interest and ability obvious enough. It had bothered me, sure. I tried not to become resentful, and of course, it was my own inertia as much as anything else which annoyed me. To add to that sense of discomfort, I also felt like I was part of a system of exploitation. Blanchard was white. I was white. While all the workers were immigrants, mostly Central and South Americans. When I said something to Blanchard about the balance of power, he'd paused.
"When did the Irish become white?" he said.
I had nothing to answer this with, but the uneasy position I was in as Blanchard's lieutenant never left me.
"When are we going to talk business?" Romeo asked.
Blanchard stopped. He looked down at the man's cowboy boots and walked towards the sausage tree. The tree had always unnerved me with its strange-shaped fruit, but it was a favourite of Blanchard's, and it had survived the hurricane somehow. He said to Romeo,
"I want you to stay by Swallow's side for a few days. Get to know your way around."
Before Romeo had a chance to protest, Mirabel appeared from under the wild tamarind. In her arms was a basket of cuttings, the fantastical colours of orchid petals.
"The humidity controller isn't working," she said. "Haven't you had a chance to look at it?"
The question was to Blanchard, but she was looking at Romeo, taking him in, before returning my gaze and pulling a strand of hair from between her lips. I knew why Romeo was here now. But who was he, I wondered, and what did he really want? I didn't have the answer to those questions at the time. I'm not sure I ever will. It's true that you meet people on the journey. They come and go. I guess you don't realize until a long time after how they changed the direction of your life, or impacted it beyond recognition for that matter.
"Mirabel," Blanchard said, raising his voice, "meet the new man."
Chapter 3.
Later in the morning, I filled the flatbed of the truck with a number of clay pots, which were beyond repair. They joined smashed glass panels, bags of refuse, and an old bent-out-of-shape cast-iron gate. The soil which bedded the assortment of trash was dank. Already it stank of growth and decay. Small discarded seedlings struggled in the rust holes and crevices of the truck. They were the stuff of desperate survival. Romeo helped me with the loading. He carried one thing after another. His demeanour was brusque, his movements measured. He threw one bag of compost into the truck like it was a corpse, returned to the debris and viewed it with something like disgust. Each one of his movements said, "This is not what I am here to do." At some stage during the season, we'd build a burn pile, throw a whole heap of stuff onto it that we didn't want around anymore. But there was a long time to go before then. Right now, Blanchard wanted the place tidied,
ship-shape and straightened up.
There was no point in hanging on to anything he might consider junk. It would only entertain his unpredictability and possible ire.
"Where are we taking this stuff?" Romeo asked.
"Harper's," I said. I knew an old Seminole who would be interested in the kind of matter we had, a curious old soul named Harper. He lived on the edge of the reservation, several hundred acres of land where the tribe had settled, and on which, over the years, a casino, hotel and museum had been built. We called it the Res. Harper's shack was on the edge of the cypress swamp. It was made out of crushed beer cans and the memorabilia of what had once been Seminole life. He built sculptures out of things people didn't want. Bottles, mattresses, old air conditioners, radiators, pipework, anything he could salvage from the junk thrown to the side of the road, or left on the dusty pavements, or discarded across the wastelands of the Res. Blanchard had been to Harper's a few times, and liked to call his yard art cockamamie. One small statue he'd made of odds and ends was of John Horse, a black Native American who'd fought bravely during one of the Seminole Wars. I guess on some level Harper related to Horse. As a black Native American himself, Harper hadn't been fully integrated into either community.
Harper was proud of the fact that he'd used his marine-issued Kabar knife to carve the statue. There was John Horse, arms akimbo, in the front yard inside a smashed TV.
"Some people call it outsider art," Harper liked to chuckle. "Outside of what?"
Before I started the truck, I popped the hood. The engine was old. It had been repaired many times, but it was still running. I slid the dipstick through my fingers. There was sufficient oil, I reckoned, to get us to where we were going and back. That was good enough. I closed the hood.
"Why are we disposing of all this when we could be doing lab work?" Romeo wanted to know. I said, "I guess this stuff needs to go. But there are more important things. Maybe there are." Interesting that he brought up the lab, I thought. I knew Romeo was right, at least about the cleanup. But I also knew there was no use in debating the point. Lab work to follow, I thought to myself, once the ghost orchid has been located. Romeo looked displeased, but it didn't stop him working. I noticed the cowboy boots were gone. He was strong, and he put his strength to use, heaving one bag after another, throwing them onto the cargo bed of the truck with a lack of care which bordered on the reckless. Still, I couldn't complain. He got the job done. When we were taking a breather, I asked, "What did you study in Belize?"
"Agricultural engineering," he said.
"So you know plants?"
"I guess."
"And you know how to grow the ghost?"
"Blanchard told you?"
"He told me some." He stood back and wiped the sweat from his brow.
"If you can get it, I can grow it."
I smiled.
"I thought it would be here," he said.
"That's what Blanchard said?"
"That's what he said."
The sun rose higher into the sky, and the day became warmer. Over the years, my body had gotten used to its unforgiving power. Long gone was the heat rash, the burns and blisters, the insomniac nights of pain and discomfort. Now the sun met my skin like an old friend. It protected me. I was so accustomed to it that whenever the temperature dropped even a little, I felt the cold, and I hated the cold more than anything. Miguel approached.
"Pick me up something, amigo," he said, looking to the ground before him and holding out a closed fist like some kind of geriatric prize fighter.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.